Center from scratch, and I think those two guilds are merging, but I would assume that one of the catalysts for that merger is people from the respective guilds quitting, so they have to come together to combine their roster. I don't know, I'm not in the guilds, that's just what I would assume. Also, Danish Terrors quit raiding, Smitus and Friends quit raiding, Exorcist, which got the Mythic Gul'dan world first kill, and also Mythic Xavius world first kill, they're talking about going casual as well. So all of these very, very high world first guilds that have been around for years are considering quitting raiding. And of course, the first thing that I think a lot of you guys are wondering is, why the fuck should you care? And I can understand it. I can see, like, you know, why would you care what a bunch of neckbeards are going to do? Oh, they're not going to play the game 20 hours a day anymore. Boo fucking who? I can understand it. But at the same time, hear me out on why I think this could kind of matter a little bit. And also, it's something that's worth considering and worth discussing at the same time, even if you don't necessarily care. So in some ways, you know, whenever you have very, very high-end players running into problems this early on in an expansion, not really this early on, but earlier in an expansion, you would kind of assume that maybe that might be a mining canary for what the problems that the rest of the player base is going to experience later on down the line. Now, I think that that's partially the problem with these high-end raiding guilds quitting, especially whenever you take into account a lot of the people that I've talked to that have been in these guilds. One of the two of the main reasons why they've quit has been, for one, time forging RNG, and also having to level up and keep their artifact weapons current, which basically what that translates to is doing Maw of Souls 1,000 times. So, big surprise, a lot of people aren't very compelled to do that, and they don't want to. And because of that, you know, they just don't really play as much. What you have to remember is that a lot of people that are in these very high-end raiding guilds, while some of them are, you know, neckbeards that live in their mom's basement and, you know, do whatever else, other ones actually do have real jobs, and obviously they play the game a lot, but at the same time, in order to do progression, they just take a couple of weeks off from work and are able to do that, and then they just go back to work after progression is over. So with having to have all these extra commitments and everything like that, and that's not just with artifact power and Titan forging and having to do like mythic plots to get like those best in slot pieces and everything, but that's also in terms of having alts. Because if you guys don't understand, this is kind of more of the world of like very high-end raiding. I'll explain what a split run is. And most high-end raiding guilds, like super high-end, like if you're in the top 10 guilds, you're probably, like a guild that's in the top 10 guilds in the world, you're probably doing at least 3, but maybe up to 5 or more split runs whenever a new raid comes out. Basically, a split run is whenever you take a raid, and half of the raid is mains, you know, or half, or 3 or 5 or, you know, 50%, a certain amount of the group is full of the main characters that you're going to take into the mythic raid the next week, and the other half, or whatever percentage it is the, you know, other people's alts or other players that they bring in, and that way they can go ahead and go in there and get loot for 30 people, but only funnel it down to 10, 5, or even 3 players. So that's going to allow them to get as much gear as possible and gear their characters out to get that extra edge going into the mythic progression. And this originally started happening basically as soon as they started. I think that it happened in like ICC a little bit, but whenever it got really common, I would say would be somewhere around Mists of Pandaria to Warlords of Draenor. Correct me if I'm wrong, though. That's where I really start to see it happen very commonly. And, you know, with the World First race, it's always kind of an arms race where if, you know, one guild is doing 5 split runs, the other guild feels like, well, we've got to do at least 5 split runs in order to stay competitive because that's what they're doing. So it's just a kind of ever-increasing amount of effort, time, and dedication that these players are putting into the game, and fundamentally they're not really getting a lot out of it. And I'm not necessarily saying this is a bad thing, but it's definitely something that's a reality. Now, what I mean by that is that whenever you get a world first in WoW, you know, MMO Champion puts you on the front page, a couple of websites do a, you know, an interview with you, and you can check WoW progress and your name's at the top. You might get a sponsorship where, you know, you might get a little bit extra money, but it's nothing even close to what you can live on. And I think that's really fundamentally what it is. The way that gaming has changed from 2007 all the way to 2017 has been massive, right? And especially recently, with how many people are streaming and how many people are making content online and making a living online and doing all of this stuff and kind of turning their hobbies or their passions into an actual career. Well, with WoW and World First Rating, a lot of times those are in some ways diametrically opposed, but in even more ways, they're just not necessarily as lucrative. So whenever you look at things like putting time into something, there's the idea of 10,000 hours, where in order to be a true master of something, you have to put 10,000 hours into whatever activity you're doing. You know, if it's playing the piano, if it's dirt biking, if it's being a rapper, if it's being good at WoW, if it's being anything, the idea is that you have to put 10,000 hours of effort into that whatever hobby, pursuits, career, whatever, in order to become a true master at it. So hypothetically, if somebody put their 10,000 hours into World of Warcraft, they're going to get a lot less out of it than if they put it into another game that has a stronger streaming scene, that has more esports rewards, more esports options, more sponsorship options, a bigger audience, and also just better prize money. Because ultimately, whenever you win World First, you don't get any prizes, right? You just get attention. And if Blizzard added sort of like money, right? If they said, okay, we're going to give them, whoever gets World First is getting $250,000. Well, for one, I mean, you got the taxes for like prize money's at 50%, but like, let's just assume that none of that's real, okay? We're living on an island with no taxes. That's $10,000 per dude, right? And it may be a little bit more because it's 20 people. It's like, what's $10,000? You're going to play all fucking day? You know, farm artifact car all day, farm Mara souls all day for $10,000 on a maybe? On a maybe you're going to do that? I mean, there's no fucking way. I mean, even if they gave them that much money, it still wouldn't even be close to what they need to. And also, why would Blizzard do that? Because they got people doing it for free. There's no reason, and I have actually, you know, I have a little bit of notes here. I try to have notes, so you guys can tell whenever I don't, because I'm rambling, like I am right now. I have right under the prize pool, I have a one word, shenanigans. Okay, because you guys know it's going to be a bunch of bullshit. How are you going to disperse the money? You know, is it only for guilds that are sponsored so they can get these organizations, and organizations pay players individually? Do all players get the same amount of money? Do, you know, who actually gets the $250 check? It seems like just a million different problems, and honestly, the best solution is to not even open the box. So that's kind of what I think Blizzard is thinking as well. And, oh, actually, really, what I think is we could spend this money or we could not. The companies, they're not going to spend the money. But fundamentally, I believe that, you know, WoW streaming, you know, there are very few streamers in WoW that really kind of, you know, they get over maybe like 2,000 or 3,000 viewers or so, and almost none, really none, get consistently get over 5,000 viewers. And so, if you're a person who wants to invest yourself entirely onto being good at a game and investing yourself entirely into gaming and, you know, making that career a profession, being a professional gamer, a professional streamer, playing World of Warcraft is a very, very bad way to go about that. So now that there are all these other options, like League of Legends, CSGO, and Variety, and other things like that, all of these other options that they can pursue, there were players that really didn't have that, but still wanted to be competitive and professional in a way, and WoW used to be kind of like the pinnacle of that. But with all in all, WoW is no longer necessarily like the pinnacle of online gaming. And some people could argue that it never was, but for a lot of people, I think that we can all agree on that it was more then than it is now. So I think that's a really big issue, and ultimately that's nothing you can really do about it. I feel like trying to create a bigger and better and more fun and inclusive, and I think fun is really the best word. You know, I don't want to use it because fun is for casuals, and these people are anything but casual. But making a more fun, engaging community, I think it's going to help everybody out. But obviously that's like something that everybody needs to do, and that's not even something that I can begin to talk about. But I also think that there's another big issue here, is that players that are quitting raiding now might have started raiding 10 years ago, okay? And so if I take, Asmongold, 26 years old now, fucking old as shit. But listen, back in the day, like, little 16-year-old Asmongold would come home and he would play WoW every single day. And I was in one of those very, very high-end raiding guilds, top 50 world guild. And we would raid 5 nights a week, Sunday night all the way to Thursday night. And then on Friday and Saturday night, we'd also do attunement runs and alt runs and everything like that. So we could do other runs, so we could kind of funnel gear like Dragon Spine trophies from, this was like during Burning Crusade days, Dragon Spine trophies to our main rogues and our main hunters, maybe a couple of warriors in our guild. And we were raiding every single night. And that took a huge amount of time, and I fucking loved it. I love doing it, and I'm never going to do it again. That's really all it is. I loved it then, and I can't do it now. I don't have the time. And even if I did have the time, I feel like I'd have to do something else because I'm older, and I feel like I'm in a different position in my life, a different place in my life, and I have to do more things than farm caravans for 100 times for Branches of Justice. And I feel like everybody kind of comes to that point, and many of the raiders that are very serious now are veteran raiders that have been playing for years, and life changes, life happens. And I feel like, you know, whenever there is such a huge increase in the expectation of time for the game that artifact power and artifact knowledge has kind of created, that it's not really a surprise that people kind of reevaluate what they're doing with their time, and they say, well, you know, maybe this isn't worth it anymore. And I feel like that's probably what's happened. And obviously, I can't really speak for anybody. I can't speak for anybody, but I can speak for myself. And that's the way that I felt. I could maybe join like a better guild. I don't really consider myself like a super amazing, oh my god, player. I consider myself good. I know what I'm doing, and I have a lot of time. But I would never spend my time raiding, you know, a top end level and WoW. I mean, in between, as I said, sport runs, everything. I mean, sport runs, artifact power farming, PTR testing, everything like that. There are just so few people that can devote that much time into an activity like that so intensively and get relatively nothing out of it. That circle and that group of people is going to be getting smaller and smaller and smaller, especially as online content, broadcasting, streaming, YouTube, etc. evolves. And I think that's really what's happening. Now, obviously, this is just my opinion, but this is my opinion. And so, what does this really mean for like the rest of the player base? I think that like having guilds like Midwinter and Exorcist considering and stopping streaming like Danish Terrorists and Postgraph to like lesser extent, especially like Midwinter, you know, they've been around since forever. And so, seeing these like very, very high end guilds quit does give a lot of people down the line a little bit more pause as to, you know, it's like kind of seeing people who you, in a way, look up to calling it quits, and so that makes you call into question, what are you doing with your time, and why are you doing this with your time? And I think a lot of people have been considering that as well. For me personally, you know, I raid 3 nights a week, 4 hours a night, and I have had a really good time. And I think that everything, ultimately, is, you know, it's like everything in moderation. Socrates had said that. And, you know, I think that's really the case. I think that Yannis Kosis did a game director now, actually. The game director, he said, it's like he didn't design the game for it to be played 80 hours a week. And that's really, of course, I think that makes sense. And so whenever you have people like this that burn themselves out by playing all this much time, and they get very little out of it, what we're seeing right now is not a surprise at all. And so it's disappointing, it's sad, but ultimately it's what you can expect. And I don't really think that we're going to see as many people coming into the game in terms of the very, very high rating scene than are coming out of it. And that's really not going to change until it can be monetized in some sort of a meaningful way, which right now that's not happening. So anyway, guys, do you think that this is an issue? Do you think that high-end rating guilds quitting is a problem? Do you even give a fuck? I'm sure that some people don't. That's fine. As I said, this is just an interesting thing. As somebody who's been very serious about playing in the past, I wanted to offer my insight on it and why I think that it's happening. And so go ahead and let me know. I'm very curious because, you know, I always read what you guys have to say, and, you know, I kind of use that, and I help that, I use that, and it helps me kind of inform my decisions in the future. But anyway, guys, we'll see what happens. We'll definitely see what happens, but I feel like, you know, as much extra requirements that we can have here to kind of provide, it's not a surprise if people are reevaluating their time and making decisions. So anyway, that's it. Thanks a lot for watching, and like, comment, and subscribe. What's up, y'all? It's me, it's your boy Asmongold, and today I want to talk to you guys about some of the new information that's come out regarding patch 7.2, Tomb of Sargeras. Now, before I get into any of this, I do want to say that this is on a PTR, which means that if you see something in this video that gets you so fucking mad, you've got to leave a comment in all caps lock. Well, you're going to do that anyway. But after you do that, go ahead and lay down, calm down, get back up, and give Blizzard some form of constructive criticism of why you don't like the thing, because the earlier in the development cycle that they get that feedback, the more likely it is for them to change things based on that feedback if they want to. That being said, a lot of new information came out today, especially in terms of like quantitative stuff. So what are going to be the artifact knowledge percentage increases modifiers from AK 26 all the way up to 40? So they actually released those, as well as a couple of other things, and also the way that AP is going to be working in patch 7.2, and that's one of the big things that I want to talk about, because I just did a video on that, and they followed up a lot of people's concerns with AP, and we'll talk about that in just a minute. Also, they're adding, for D3 players, they're adding Kadala into WoW. For people who don't know what that is, you can buy items from it and identify it legendary people out. Now, also, they're adding mounts into the emissary caches, which is cool, and a number of other things like loading screens for the winter Altrak is always winter. The Arathi Basin thing, and a couple of other like little minor things that I want to go through with you guys. But the first thing I want to talk about is obviously the AP stuff and the AK stuff, because that was what I just talked about in my last video, and I want to kind of get that out of the way to just completely deal with that. So, in patch 7.2, obviously they're going to be getting rid of the Paragon trait that we have right now that increases your damage, right? And so people thought, okay, so they're getting rid of that trait, and now all you have to do is level up your weapon, and it's going to take a long time, it's kind of gated by artifact knowledge, and after you're done, right? Your weapon's done. So they got rid of the 20 trait Paragon thing, and they added a 50 trait Paragon trait, okay? 50 rank Paragon trait. It's called Concordance of the Lucian Call. Your abilities have a chance to trigger Concordance of the Lucian Call, increasing your primary stat for 11,800 for 10 seconds. So, obviously, and the way that this works, the way that the scaling works, is that you're never going to get this. Okay, if I understand it correctly, you're never going to get this. My understanding is that you need about 4 billion artifact power in order to fully level up your weapon outside of the Concordance traits, and then you need something like 134 or 178, I believe, billion artifact power in order to fully level up the Concordance traits. And in order to get the 4 billion artifact power, you need, I think, 346 Moloch Souls runs on Mythic Quest level 79. So it's like you're gonna get 178 billion. It's not gonna happen. So this is, for all intents and purposes, an infinitely scaling trait, and I don't like it. I don't like infinitely scaling things. I like to be able to finish things. Okay, I just like to be able to finish things. So you guys know that about me. So I don't want to beat a dead horse. But what I do want to do is I do want to show you guys and talk to you guys about some of the new posts that have been made in response to your concerns about this trait and about the way that artifact knowledge and artifact power is going to be working in the infinite, I guess, like, infinite way. And before I do that, I just want to give you guys an idea on what artifact knowledge is going to scale to, okay? So artifact knowledge 26 is going to be 50,000, artifact knowledge 30 is going to be 125,000, artifact knowledge 35 is going to be 380,000, artifact knowledge 38 is going to be 745,000, and artifact knowledge 40, which is the max level, is going to be 1,165,000% increase in artifact power gains. That's a big number, and you're going to think like a million, all a billion's easy. Like guys, a billion is 1,000 millions. Okay, just think about that. Even with 40 AK, this is going to take forever. All right, just so you understand. Now, all that being said, let's go ahead and look at what people's concerns are with the artifact power and artifact knowledge here, okay? And if I got those numbers wrong, please go ahead and let me know. I don't think that I did, though. I did a little bit of research on this. So anyway, this is in response to people's concerns, okay? The individual ranks are less impactful. This is honestly one of our biggest issues with the 7.0 design. Grinding out a couple million artifact power for 0.5% raw damage increase was just too lucrative compared to other methods of in-game progression. even eclipsing some gear for players. The goal for 7.2 design is to visit the next rank. It's still an increase. You won't turn it down, but it's not your primary focus. So it's to pretty much make artifact power this overarching, always useful reward. So you never really want to lose your artifact. And, you know, I don't really, as I said, I feel like there should be a game that's on the site, but this is obviously not what they're trying to do. They're trying to actually have the opposite. And number two, the rate at which the cost for the next increases, rate at which the cost for the next rank increases is higher in patch 7.0 design. Someone who farmed twice as much AP as you had roughly twice as many ranks as you. While rewarding the extra effort isn't a bad thing, it doesn't need to be nearly that rewarding. By making each rank's cost exponentially more, we can help ensure that you're never too far behind, even if you aren't spending too much time farming AP. It also means that the artifact knowledge is up. Quick aside, context, it's not what's happening. Change number three, the new trait gives a primary stat bonus instead of a percentage based increase. I thought the percentage based increase was a bad idea too. I feel like this is a better idea. Maybe it might be a better idea. I also like having a flat damage increase, so I don't have advantages, but basically the percentage increase allowed people to scale even harder past what they kind of wanted. So if you're doing 100,000 DPS, you have a 20% increase, you're doing 120,000. If you're doing 200,000 DPS and you have a 20% increase, you're doing 240%, 240,000 DPS. So the bigger your original number is, obviously the more the percentage is going to increase it by. So it kind of created an even bigger power gap that I can see why they want to get rid of, okay? Basically, this is what they said. Again, the goal here is to reduce the overall power gap. And finally, number four, it's a proc. I know anything that involves it is quite controversial. But this is, in my opinion, a great example of when this proc is extremely useful. And this is for two reasons. First, it muddies the waters a bit, because the big thing that you want to do whenever you're doing any sort of progression rate just based on numerical difficulty is not be able to understand where things are going wrong. Whenever you wipe on a boss at 1% or barely miss a kill window, it can be easy to say, Todd is doing 2% more damage, you get 1, but whenever it's a proc, you can't actually be that sure. That's because you can't factor procs into your damage, of course. How does StimCraft even work? Can't actually be sure. Maybe Todd needs more AP, or maybe he just got unlucky with his procs. So this is great. Now you're going to wipe because of procs. Maybe the wipe wasn't Todd's fault at all. Maybe you should be a little bit nicer to Todd. Maybe you should design it. Second, more importantly, it allows the player player skill to play more of a factor. That's because, you know, obviously you're going to be saving your cooldowns waiting for this random proc. If you're the sort of player that can pay attention to procs and adjust the rotation on the fly, say if you're using better spells or DPS using bigger spells, you're going to get more value out of your new trait than someone who ignores it. Obviously you are, but in almost every situation I know as a Fury Warrior, you're never saving your cooldowns. You're always using them as soon as they come up. So they either come up whenever your cooldowns come up, the proc comes up whenever your cooldowns come up, or it doesn't. One or the other, you're using the cooldown no matter what. And so this is responding to a little bit more criticism. I haven't been a hardcore progression raider for a few years now, but I can tell you with absolute certainty that wiping at 1% due to poor procs / RNG is infinitely infinitely worse than simply needing a bit more gear to push you towards that kill. I understand where you're coming from, but personally, I disagree. I don't see how somebody could disagree with having the success of their raid be based on random. But okay. For me, knowing that we just got unlucky means that it's worth it to try again. No, it's just demoralizing. Oh, we didn't get lucky. Like, wow, we lose. That feels great. And hope for a different result, whereas we just don't have enough gear and AP means that we should give up and come back next week. And then you come back next week, and after you reach a certain point in the game, you've achieved enough, you're able to get to a new level. Why does everything have to be fucking random? Either way, I don't like to say something right that 1% was painful, but more to say that's hard to plan on Todd skipping last week with the plus farm before that. So here you are designing an entire game around obviously a player that basically, so this is a two-part problem. For one, they're designing the entire game around players that are not fundamentally motivated to actually increase their damage and increase their power in raids. And also, the way that you increase your damage and the way that you increase your power in raids is through a method of doing something that for a lot of people is not fun and it's very repetitive and they don't want to do. So it's like, it's crazy. I don't get it. I don't understand how. I feel like the AP, the AK, the legendary, all this stuff, it's gotten to be such a on such a contrived level. It's like you have to think at a certain point, man, like we're having to do all this weird stuff. Maybe we just shouldn't have this in the game. That's just me. And it's okay. This is the second thing that people are saying. I rarely gamble because I understand odds and know that the house is usually comes out on top. Well, I was starting to feel the same way. Obviously, you need some random elements to keep everything from being completely methodological. Why can I not say that word? Basically, it happens the exact same way every time. But it's getting really overboard. Sure, I can see that. And just to be clear, we're intentionally keeping the proc pretty flat. It should feel somewhat reliable even if it is 100% uptime. It's gonna be if it's gonna be pretty flat, then wouldn't it just kind of still be a DPS increase? I mean, you can factor in procs as DPS increases. Also worth mentioning that the above number four is just my opinion of a guy. Yeah, I mean, I disagree with that opinion completely. But okay. The issue is that you're creating a problem on the flip side of the coin where power gains are so small that they don't seem worth pursuing, and then each rank becomes less and less valuable compared to the previous. Frankly, just don't do it. Just get rid of the infinite trade completely. Artifact power tokens have little value, so cut progression off after the four ranks, and the new trades are maxed. Let players transition into getting 1-2% upgrades per year after they got the artifacts and hinder the tokens for the rest. And then this is the response. This is what's concerned a lot of people. We honestly don't see that as a problem. In fact, it's kind of the goal. So the goal, their goal is to create an infinite grind. This is the goal. So at this point, for a player like me that's a completionist, there is never going to be a point where I can finish the game. And I don't like that. Okay, let me just say that. If you decide it's not worth grinding a few million AP to get another 200 agility, a few million, dude. It's funny. To get another 200 agility on your proc, great, we don't want you to feel obligated to. We do, however, want to make you make sure you always find artifact power that you come across to be valuable. More agility might not be enough to convince you to find the AP needed to find it, but you're not going to turn it down either. I can understand their ideology. I definitely can, but it feels like a lot of these decisions that they make are being made by people that don't really play the game. They don't understand the social dynamics of the game. It feels like they're making design decisions for a game that doesn't have any multiplayer elements. And I just don't really think like having an infinite power phrase is going to be good no matter what. I really just don't think so. It seems like a complete, huge fucking mistake, and it's really disappointing that they're even considering it. I don't know. It seems like a really, really bad idea. So that's basically what's happening today. As I said, I'm not really a huge fan of it. You know, like, we'll see what happens. I hope that they give people some form of closure to what they're doing in the game. I feel like it's very rewarding to get that closure. You know, finishing your artifact weapon does give people that closure, and in patch 7.2, that will, again, one more thing that will no longer exist as an end to a grind. So also, people were wondering about the legendary items that are going to be crafted items that can be legendary. You can craft legendary items in patch 7.2. They will have procs. One of them, I believe, I'm just doing this from memory, I think it increases your... I think you heal for 2% of your health every, like, 5 or 10 seconds or something like that, while enemies are nearby, and whenever enemies are not nearby, you have that movement speed increase, and that would be playable, I believe. Also, so the Kadala thing, that's the next thing I want to talk about. Kadala is basically in Diablo 3, it's a vendor that you can use blood shards, which are the equivalent of, like, artifact power or valor points or justice points, and you can spend, let's say, 100 justice points or 100 valor points, and you can buy a random shoulder item. And that random shoulder item can have, you know, using WoW terms, a green shoulder, a blue shoulder, an epic shoulder, or a legendary shoulder. Okay, so they're adding that into WoW. And the way that it's going to work is the vendor needs to see, and it's the exact same as Canon Jungle, where you can buy like the Baleful Helm. And you buy the Baleful Helm, and you identify the Baleful Helm, and it can have random stats. I'm assuming this will be the same way. It can upgrade to, at that point, 695. And the difference here is that, I don't know, I'm assuming they don't have a Titan Force cap, but the other difference is that they can actually turn into legendaries. Now, we don't really know at this point what the costs are actually going to be, but from what I see here, obviously they're extremely expensive, and I don't think that it's really meant to be a way for you to kind of target a legendary in a certain way, but obviously people are going to use it and like that. I don't know, I guess it's better than not having it, but I can see why people don't like it. I don't really have too much of an opinion on it one way or another. Now, another thing I do actually want to mention this is that this is a good thing that I think they're doing is that in patch 7.2, there's a lot of new achievements for getting all the different sets and all the different transmog sets. So if you want to have those ahead of time, go ahead and collect all of your tier 5, tier 4, you know, tier 10, tier 15 tier sets, and collect all the PvP season sets, and you'll have achievements for all of those whenever the patch 7.2 comes out. We want to mention that right offhand. Also in patch 7.2, the new brawlers, PvP brawlers are coming out, and they added a loading screen for the Winterrack. Every single time I say that, I say Alterac Valley, and I was trying so hard not to say it, and I fucked up Winter. The Winter Rappy Basin, the brawl, and so that actually does, I really, really like the word that. And on top of that, the Hamster that we're going to be getting in patch 7.2 will now have a chance to drop a mount. I'm assuming, at least I'm assuming from each place, the High Mountain Tribes, the High Mountain ones have a chance to give you a boost. The Balajar can give you a Storm Drake, awesome. The Kirin Horde can give you a flying carpet that's usable by people who aren't tailors. The Dream Reavers give you one of those, those unicorns that ride around in Balajar. It gives you one of those. And the Court of Ferondas or the Wardens, I'm not really sure which one, gives you another colored Hippogriff. You can see all of those right here. And so that's cool. I think that's awesome. I do not want to say one way or another, if you save all of your caches right now, will that be a different, item ID than the caches that post 7.2 that can possibly contain these mounts? I can't say. I hope Blizzard says one way or another, so people can either save them or not save them if they do want to try and farm for these mounts. But I think that's really cool. I like it a lot. I kind of felt like it would be cool if they had made the Stormdrakes Gladiator exclusive to give them PvPers something unique. But looks like that's not going to happen. Anyway, guys, those are all the changes that are going to be happening in patch 7.2, or at least all the new ones that have been announced today. I think that's pretty much everything I've gone over. I just want to scroll down here for all the different news. Yeah, nothing else really in here. It's mostly just the AK stuff and AP stuff and the Kabbalah and the Lyrics of the Titans. So that's pretty much it, guys. Go ahead and let me know what you think. As I said before, I'm not very happy with the ideology behind the infinitely scaling traits. I don't like that at all, but I'm not going to get into that too much because I already have many times before. And all the other stuff you guys pretty much saw. Anyway, please go ahead and let me know what you think. Let me know kind of, what do you like, what do you not like? I'm kind of curious, and if there's something that you don't like, don't just let me know. Make sure to let Blizzard know as well, and also let them know if there's something you do like, because then they might do more of that as well. So anyway, guys, that's pretty much all I've got for today. Thank you very much for watching, and hopefully this was helpful. This will help you. I don't know which one I was trying to say, but I kind of did both. Hopefully it was helpful, and like, comment, and subscribe.